Welcome back to this evening event at the conference at the Deathbed of Capitalism. We're very honored and very pleased to have Susan George here with us tonight as the key lecturer and the senior lecturer. It really is an honor for us to have you here, and it's an honor for me personally too. You really don't need an introduction, but since you're one of the leading global and public intellectuals of the left, but I will do it anyway. Susan George has been, like I said, one of the leading intellectuals of the left, and she has been a public intellectual. She has been with social movements for more than four decades. She's been on the board of Greenpeace International. She's been the vice president of ATTAC, even like a founder of ATTAC, which in France. And she's now a fellow of the Transnational Institute in Amsterdam. She's written extensively after she received her PhD in political science from Sorbonne University in France, originally born in the United States in Akron, Ohio. And she's written numerous books about debt imperialism, about the exploitation and domination of the global south by the global north. And we're very happy to have you here and to give the key lecture. Just just a few comments about what's going to happen now. Susan George is going to speak for about 50 to 60 minutes, and then we'll have a Q&A session. We'll be collecting questions. And Susan asked me to tell you that if you're uncomfortable to ask a question in English, definitely ask it in German, and it'll be simultaneously translated. We have the translators in the back. Make sure if you would like to have a translation into German that you pick up the equipment. One thing that I want you to take notice of is that we have lists of all the participants. As you know, the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation is funded by the German government, and the German government wants to know not who in particular was here, but that the number of people who were here, and this is the evidence that we give them that we have those lists. So the list will be.
We are funded by the German people, yeah? By the taxpayers.
That's right. So the list will be passed around. If you haven't, they've been passed around in the previous session, but if you haven't signed it yet, please do so. And now, without further ado, I give the word to Susan George.
Thank you and good evening. It's an enormous pleasure to be here. And I am the one who is honored because I think the work of the foundation is remarkable and you have been very steadfast for a long time. And so I'm extremely pleased to be here and to participate in this way in your work. I'm sorry I can't speak to you in your own language. But you are all well-educated people, and I know many of you will be listening to the original, which I hope is okay, because I'm not a theoretician, and Ingar is far too generous saying I'm a leading left intellectual, because I'm really an empiricist. I'm from the American tradition. I'm not an economist, and there are many things that I don't know. So. Let's get started. I want to warn you right away about something, which is that my mother always told me I was the most tactless woman she had ever known. And I am going to be critical right from the start, because I want to live up to my reputation, which would make my mother glad, I'm sure. So the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation wants me to speak on the topic the death at the deathbed of capitalism, with a question mark, which is a wise precaution. But when I first saw the title, I wrote to the organizers to say that in my view, capitalism had been on its deathbed for so long that I hoped someone had come around now and then to change the sheets, because even capitalism did not deserve to be left in the same bed for so many years with the same sheets, for decades, because it seems that capitalism, we've been announcing this death for quite a long time. And that is how I learned by writing to the organizers that I was given the same title as that of a recent best-selling German book. I can't read German, and I have no idea what the author, Wolfgang Streck, has to say. And I can't judge any of the other books that have been published. Apparently, there's a great many recently published in Germany, and I'm told that the fashion now, intellectually here, is to answer the question, are we at the deathbed of capitalism, in the affirmative, and to say, yes, we are. Capitalism finally is finished. It's on its deathbed, and we're all invited to the funeral. Well, bravo and hurrah if that's true. But let's not celebrate too soon. If capitalism dies, I believe it could be very likely for reasons that are deeply threatening to humanity and to civilization. Well, does that mean that I support the continuation of capitalism forever and ever, amen? No, of course not. But I believe the old saying may be relevant to our present situation. Be careful what you wish for, because you might get what you want. So before I start to explain further, you should also know that the foundation made another request. They've asked me to try to answer the following two vital questions. I quote, to deal with two sides, the current crisis and the crisis of the left, to provide answers to the crisis. Wow. In one short sentence, I'm asked to solve three crises: how we got where we are, why the left isn't living up to its prescribed role, and therefore why we don't have any satisfactory solutions on the table. I think you will agree that this is a daunting assignment. It's also another opportunity for me to be tactless. Not only has the deathbed of capitalism been occupied for a long time, although the patient seems to me to be in quite good health, but furthermore, I don't think we're dealing with one crisis or even three crises. If you want answers or even a few clues about the future of capitalism and therefore our own future, we should start by respecting the meaning of the words that we use. And like so many important words, crisis comes from the Greek. And in Greek, the verb closest to it means to judge. For example, it could concern the verdict of a court of law, or it could be a personal decision I have to make to know how to behave in one situation or another. But under no circumstances is it a decision or an action or a situation that lasts for weeks, months, or years. We are now in 2017. The subprime crisis started in the United States in 2007, and the fall of Lehman Brothers was in 2008. That's when it exploded. In other words, we've been talking about a crisis for nearly a decade. Here's further etymological proof that crisis is not the right word. For Hippocrates, the Greek physician, the great Greek physician for whom the name of the oath of Hippocrates is named, is that point in an illness where the patient is either going to recover or die. This moment could conceivably return once or twice, but it is not a long, drawn-out phenomenon. You can have a critical day or two in an illness, but you can't have a critical year. If the deathbed of capitalism has been occupied for so long, then it's contradictory to talk about a crisis. Our world is sick, yes, but this sickness isn't a crisis. Actually, I wish it were, because then we could at least grit our teeth and say to each other, well, it's terrible, and it hurts like hell, but it's going to be over pretty soon, so hang on. No, this has been a long decade of deteriorating economy and a worsening political and social landscape, especially for ordinary Europeans. It's the result of a long period of preparation, culminating in the spectacular collapse of 2007-2008, followed by massive blood transfusions and a recovery of sorts. The banks were saved, after all. The chief economist of the Bank of England estimates total bank bailouts of Western capitalist countries at a total of $14 trillion. That is 14 followed by 12 zeros. Since nobody can rationally deal with these numbers, imagine if you have a second hand on your watch, imagine that each second that passes is $1. Well, you have to, if you want to arrive at $14 trillion, you're going to have to wait and look at your watch for 448,000 years. That's how much was spent on saving the banks. Despite this astronomical contribution of public money to rescuing an utterly irresponsible banking system, the banks were not nationalized or socialized. And to my knowledge, except for Iceland, none of the bankers responsible were put in jail, although their actions deprived the countries that rescued them of the necessary funds to pay for everyday expenses and better services for their populations. And today, Donald Trump is busy removing the few regulations they had to accept after the collapse. So we're now so deeply immersed in another prolonged period of suffering, with the addition of austerity policies which make recovery more difficult and the situation far worse than it could have been or should have been. And to be even more tactless than before, I must add that these austerity policies are largely imposed on Europe by Germany. As the Financial Times economic commentator Wolfgang Munchau has said, there are two kinds of German economists, those who haven't read Keynes and those who haven't understood Keynes. Whichever they are, these economists, your finance minister, Herr Schäuble, and the European Commission that listens to these economists are pushing the European economy towards breakdown and the European Union towards suicide. Capitalism has fewer constraints today than at any time in the past 70 years. All this is to say that, in my view, we're not plunged into a crisis, but instead we're suffering from a chronic degenerative disease deeply lodged in the body of capitalism, of the capitalist economy. The disease was contracted many, many years before 2007, and it can continue for many years to come. But this malady, like some cancers, has also long periods of remission. Maybe capitalism will collapse and die in the long run. But as Keynes said, in the long run, we're all dead. We are swept along with the tide of a process that I would say it is even a program, in the sense of a computer process, a computer program. The years 2007-2008 may have been the beginning of the present phase, but I'm sorry to say we can't, or at least I can't, predict its end, because this program has been so pervasive, it's so entrenched and so protected that it seems invulnerable. So as not to keep you in suspense, the name of this program and the cause of our long-term degenerative disease is neoliberalism. Most people, that includes practically everyone under the age of 40, do not even recognize or remember that there was ever a program different from today's program. Maybe capitalism will die, but of what? Suffocation? Strangling? A lucky shot that goes straight through the heart? Or just plain old age and exhaustion? Or, one has to ask, because it will, perhaps it will die because that's when civilization dies too. This is very far from being just an economic problem. Who or what might provide the instrument or the medicine that could rid us of this diseased system and change that program? The big question now is what might be the limits and the barriers to the power of capitalism today? The answer requires a bit of history. Don't worry, I don't intend to take you back to 1492 or go through the whole history of 18th to 20th century industrial capitalism and on to Fordism. When Henry Ford said, "I pay my workers so they can buy my cars," he meant it, and they did buy his cars. But Fordism ushered in an era of much greater prosperity and mass consumption for workers. It may have still been exploitative, but the state of workers improved. Economies were primarily national, but the Great Depression intervened because the prevailing economic organization not only allowed, but encouraged rampant speculation. The October 1929 stock market collapse brought enormous unemployment and hardships. It was followed by the mild recovery initiated after the election of Franklin Roosevelt in 1932 and his New Deal. I've heard many people say that Roosevelt saved capitalism with the New Deal, and that may be true, but it was World War II and its aftermath which really gave capitalism wings. The war's devastation led to huge, unfulfilled demand for all kinds of goods, and the period that followed was one of unprecedented prosperity. The major victor of World War II, of course, which was the United States, was the only country to have suffered no destruction, and it did not want to be outdistanced by the socialist bloc in making social improvements. Returning American soldiers were given their own Bill of Rights. They could enroll in universities and get a college degree free of charge. Salaries increased, and poverty for most groups, though not for all African Americans, declined. The Marshall Plan was instated for Europe. Naturally, this was not pure charity. The United States wanted its partners, its former partners in Europe, to be able to trade again, and their economies were utterly destroyed. But the Marshall Plan still contributed hugely to European recovery. President Truman launched the Point Four program in 1948, and it became the blueprint for the development industry in what we used to call the Third World. In the post-World War II period in Europe, a consistent buildup of what came to be known as the welfare state was took place, with exponential improvements in healthcare, education, housing, and so on, as well as in public ownership and management of major industries such as electricity, communications, mass transport, or mutualist organizations such as banks or savings and loan institutions, insurance, and the like. In France, the post-war social and political program was written by the Conseil National de la Résistance, and it was while the Germans were still occupying France that this program was written. It included universal health care, la sécurité sociale, and it was taken extremely seriously by the post-war governments and their economic planners. Trade unions gained lots of memberships and significant power, and labor laws were improved. The state was expected to create universal social services, to intervene forcefully in the management of the economy, and to tax capital and wealthy individuals accordingly. A single example. Under US President Eisenhower, a Republican, the top bracket of earnings for the richest people was taxed at 90%. Younger people today have no experience of this era or of the welfare state, publicly managed capitalism, and full employment, or at least not in most countries. It wasn't utopia, and there was still plenty of room for improvement, but it was miles ahead of the economies of the 1920s and the 1930s, even under Roosevelt's New Deal. Public spending increased rapidly, and although today's mainstream economists generally refuse to admit it, public spending is the key to creating employment, not just in the public sector, but also in the private sector. All this took place under vigorous democracies, again, not ideal, not perfect, but vibrant and for the most part honest. Winston Churchill's remark, saying when he said, "Democracy is the worst form of government, except for all the other systems that have been tried," was a true statement. Today, however, we can't go back to the exuberant age of largely national industrial capitalism, if only because the environment cannot sustain a system based on constantly increasing extraction, mass consumption, and greenhouse gas emissions. But that's not the reason that a major change in the capitalist universe began to take place at the beginning of the 1970s. The left did not realize it at the time, but a good part of the upper class, or if you prefer, la bourgeoisie in the Marxist sense, had never accepted the New Deal. It had never accepted the welfare state and the far more egalitarian societies of the post-war period. These forces, at first very much in the minority, began to plan for a return to the freewheeling, deregulated capitalist policies of post-World War I period, and they wanted little or no government interference. It didn't matter that this bourgeoisie and these policies had, after World War I, led to rampant financial speculation, cutthroat competition between countries, and eventually to World War II. The bourgeoisie did not care. This movement was intellectually centered on the University of Chicago, with its prestigious professor of economics, Friedrich von Hayek, and his star pupil, Milton Friedman. This movement eventually secured huge financial contributions from private US foundations based on chemicals, iron and steel, and armaments. Their collective goal was to create and nurture what we can now call neoliberal capitalism, and to construct the legal governmental policy framework which would protect and extend it. Thanks largely to this lavish funding and careful preparation, the neoliberal revolution took state power with the elections of Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher at the end of the 1970s. This is also when I believe that the left lost the plot. In other words, progressives, social democrats, and even communists had no idea what was going on. And because they never understood what hit them, they did not unite against the spreading neoliberal movement, and they did not have a strategy to counter it. This may also remind you of Europe in the 1930s. The neoliberal militants, however, knew exactly what they were doing. I call them the right-wing Gramscians, because they understood Antonio Gramsci and his concept of cultural hegemony far better than the left. The neoliberals set out to change the culture of the West, and they used what Gramsci called the long march through the institutions. To this end, they funded all kinds of idea-producing and idea-disseminating entities. They founded think tanks, created and paid for university departments of law and economics. They financed films, television shows, lectures, publications at every level, from the scholarly, quarterly, right down to the campus newspaper. They set up a tightly knit organization called the Federalist Society for lawyers, judges, professors of law. Business, which had, perhaps surprisingly, previously participated very little in American policymaking, became much more active in promoting unregulated capitalism. And they promoted it through lobbying and with all sorts of public relations enterprises. These well-trained idea formulators, speakers, and writers gradually occupied the talk shows, the newspaper and magazine columns, the university lecture platforms, and they quietly took over everyday concepts and language, substituting their own vocabulary to fit their ideological preferences. Neoliberalism became the new common sense, first in the United States and in Britain, later in Europe and the rest of the world. It's hard to calculate how much was spent on this endeavor, but one scholar claims that between 1982 and 2002 alone, $1 billion was dedicated to changing what Americans think. And it was worth it to the neoliberals. The design and the implementation of their program worked. It freed capitalism from a great many rules and regulations, and it made capitalist owners and executives incredibly rich. The left, if it thought at all about what was happening, apparently believed that its own ideas, values, and institutions were great as they were. They didn't need protection, they didn't need defense, they didn't need promotion. Some progressive US foundations still funded projects, but they never funded ideas. Their projects were set up to help this or that deprived section or group, but they tended to last only as long as the money kept coming, and that was usually for about 3 years. The gist of this long story is that progressives have lost the battle of ideas. Capitalism, deregulation, privatization, private wealth have won. Taxes have been deeply cut or eliminated. Corporations have been deregulated and finance freed from constraints. Most people were conquered by this ideology and found all of this normal. It's a dream world for capitalism as the outcome. I would be extremely happy if this post-1970s neoliberal capitalist system were about to crumble. But I see few signs of it, frankly. Although it's still too early to determine what the new policies of the Trump presidency may provoke, I fear he may do his best to protect and enhance the neoliberal system. Why else would he fill his cabinet with billionaires and chief executives of some of the largest companies? Europe is not going to be any better off. Here's one proof of capitalism's success on our continent. Economists routinely measure the shares of gross domestic product allocated to capital and to labor in any given year. That is to say, they measure the shares of wages and of salaries that are going to labor, to working people, and they measure the money accruing to capital in dividends or rents. In the mid-1970s, this is getting a little technical, I'm sorry, but it's easy to get a hold of. In the middle of the 1970s, the average share of European GDP going to capital was approximately 30%, and therefore labor, working people, were getting 70%. At present, capital's share has risen to approximately 40%. So labor is now getting 60%, down by 10%. Since the annual GDP of Europe is around 16 trillion euros, this means that working people are now losing approximately 1.6 trillion a year, every year, and have been losing for decades. And the amount that they have lost has gone to enrich capital. It's not exactly what you could call a disaster for capitalism. And don't forget either that the share that goes to salaries includes bonuses and stock options for the executives who are making now up to 400 or 500 times as much as their salaried workers. Furthermore, the companies used to have to pay fairly stiff taxes to finance the public good, but they've found many ways to avoid and evade them. Whereas governments govern mostly in the interests of the largest transnational corporations and banks, small and medium enterprises have not fared nearly so well. The TTIP and the CETA are the most recent examples of the privileges granted to the biggest transnational firms. In 2017, even lobbyists may lose their jobs, since President Trump is putting corporations directly in charge of the government. Why bother with lobbyists or other middlemen when you can have the former president of ExxonMobil, Rex Tillerson, as Secretary of State? Don't need lobbyists then. You might counter this view by bringing up the questions of Bernie Sanders, the Occupy movement, Jeremy Corbyn, and the new and vibrant city governments in Spain, such as Madrid and Barcelona, or even ATAC, my organization, which is now active in many European countries. Like you, I hope that such people and such movements may be signs of the future. But for now, I'm afraid they are simply very bright and hopeful stars in a galaxy of neoliberalism. Brexit and the election of Donald Trump show that justified popular discontent, popular anger, favor the right, and neoliberal propaganda. This machine of neoliberal propaganda seems in perfect working order. In the 1930s, a similar machine made Jews and homosexuals and communists the enemy. Today, it's immigrants, Muslims, the LGBT, or the women's movement. So far, I haven't been able to find any barriers or limits to capitalism, but let's keep looking. Despite the remarkable advantages already given to it, what forces might be at work to cause capitalism's downfall? Might they come from the huge mass, both in dimensions and in population, that we used to call the Third World? So far, we've stayed pretty much in the North, but the North is also where the deathbed of capitalism is supposed to be located, so that's justified. But since the population of the North, the capitalist North, only comes to about 15% of humanity, maybe the 85% living in what we used to call the Third World could pose a limit to capitalist development. My answer is that we shouldn't count on that. Despite globalization, these countries, with few exceptions, such as China, are not as important to the West as they used to be. During the Cold War, when the West was the First World, the Soviet Union and its satellites were the Second World, everybody else was in the Third World. And the capitalist West had to pay close attention to what was happening in those countries, because any one of them could at any time become a political and military base for the influence of the opposing side, the Soviet Union. These countries were also useful reservoirs and handy for extracting particular resources or export crops that could be underpaid on world markets and then not fall into the wrong hands, which would have been the hands of the Soviets. Between the end of World War II and the fall of the wall here in Berlin, the Cold War was the overriding geopolitical reality. The capitalist world feared most of all two, three, many Cubas, or many Vietnams, as Che Guevara would have said. And parts of the former Third World are good examples of trying to improve the lot of the people. But they are no threat to world capitalism, and I believe it is simply grotesque to believe, as Obama apparently did, that a Latin American country such as Venezuela could be a genuine threat to the United States. Now that the Cold War is well and truly over, now that the specter of communism, more accurately called authoritarian state socialism, is no longer haunting Europe or the USA, not only are the concept and the industry of development in quotes, fast disappearing, but nearly all the elites, aside from a few odd cases such as North Korea, are enthusiastically cooperating in the capitalist project. The Davos Doctrine and its propaganda of globalization have taken the place of development, and the word globalization hides another cover-up. It sounds good, as if we were all holding hands together and marching towards the promised land, a land of prosperity and happiness for all. Sorry, but that's not the case. In my view, capitalist globalization is the program that takes the best and leaves the rest. It takes the best people, the best resources, and the best sources of capital. Oxfam's yearly press releases on the occasion of the Davos Festival in January announced that a few dozen billionaires have as much wealth as several billion people born in the wrong place. Capitalism is doing just fine, and the southern elites ask only to join in. The growing size of the rich-poor gap seems not to matter to them at all. The NGO called Global Financial Integrity employs former IMF economists who are fed up with the IMF. And they say in their annual reports that nearly $1 trillion, that's 1 + 12 zeros, gets siphoned off out of the global south every year. A lot of these transfers are considered legal because they are due to price manipulation by the transnational corporations, transfer pricing and other mechanics like that. Part of the transfer, however, is blatantly illegal, and quite a lot is due to the southern elites taking their money to the north, to the global north. They have also joined the new international, nearly homogenous social class I call the Davos class. No barriers to capitalism there either. If capitalism has little to fear from the southern hemisphere, what about the powerful shift in the industrial north towards robotics, self-driving vehicles, artificial intelligence? Could those contribute to the demise of capitalism? Shifts and shocks like this have occurred from capitalism's earliest days and always took a long time to be absorbed and heal, but they've never killed the beast. The next transition is also likely to be painful for many, but not insurmountable. Lots more people will find themselves in precarious employment or none at all, but new industries will spring up, and states have the means to compensate at least partially for job losses. Military Keynesianism also seems to be performing according to plan, with armaments still the world's top export, top money maker, and economic stimulus. Sorry. So having eliminated all these possibilities, I see only two possible reasons why the deathbed argument could be true. And frankly, I'd rather not contemplate either of those, because both are beyond horrible. The first possible cause of capitalist collapse is the increasing complexity and interconnectedness of the largest and most profitable corporations and their complete capture of manufacturing, services, and especially the financial industries. A remarkable scientific paper published in 2011 by three Zurich Polytechnic researchers in complex systems, they're mathematicians, is a revealing and frightening paper. These scholars map out the interconnectedness of more than 40,000 transnational corporations. That is, who owns what part of who else? That's interconnectedness. And via one reduction after another, they conclude that a mere 147 very large transnational corporations possess, in one way or another, 40% of the total sample of 40,000. The final reduction that these mathematicians make is to the 50 most interconnected companies in the world. And this group of 50 displays what these scholars call the knife edge property. In other words, if any serious event, such as the sudden collapse and bankruptcy of Lehman Brothers, were to happen to any one of these 50 companies, their complexity of size, subsidiaries, and ownership are so interconnected that the whole structure of all 50 could fall like a row of dominoes, like that. Most frightening of all is that, with two exceptions, which are Walmart and the China Petroleum Group, all the corporations on the list of 50 are financial. They're banks, hedge funds, insurance, or other financial service industries. If this is true, and it certainly seems to be, and if a spectacular failure of one of the 50 occurs, I needn't tell you what chaos this would mean for everyone. The monetary system would cease functioning overnight. Anyone with an income, a bank account, insurance, savings, social security, a job, or a business would lose them. And since these scholars, writing in 2010-2011, were using a list which had been published earlier for their 50 companies, I should tell you too that Lehman Brothers was on that list. And when the Lehman Brothers failed, what happened to the economy? It would be much, much worse if it happens again. So more and more researchers see complexity as the hidden killer waiting to strike down capitalism, as well as just about everything and everybody else. By comparison, Lehman and the events of 2008 and afterwards would be seen as simply a minor hiccup. What's more, at least 8 years after 2008, the Lehman Brothers crash was still being unwound because it was so difficult to sort out who owed money to whom. It makes you shiver. What would it be like if we had 2, 3, or 50 Lehman Brothers? The second potential cause I can see for the death of capitalism would also entail the death of the planet as we have known it, and would make our economic system look extremely trivial. If capitalism continued to insist on overheating our only home and drowning it in greenhouse gases and rising oceans, then it will succeed only in taking everything and everyone else with it, including civilization and the lives of most members of most species, including humans. Environmentalists have for years been trying to inform capitalism and capitalists that they can't simply follow their own rules, but also they must obey the rules of the earth. These include the laws of physics, chemistry, and biology, and these laws will triumph over petty human preferences for profits every time. To disobey the laws of nature is automatically to fail. Our problem lies in delivering this message. So now I come to the final part of the Foundation's assignment to me, and I quote again, the crisis of the left to provide, to provide answers to the crisis. I think on the contrary, that the left has really been pretty good at finding answers to the crisis. It's provided a lot of practical proposals and practical answers, which we could apply to making our economic world safer and to improving our societies. We know what to do to avoid another Lehman-type crash. The first thing to do is to get the banks under control, separate investment banking from commercial banking, nationalize the biggest banks, recover the money that is now stashed in tax havens, tax the 1%, and build the mechanisms that would ensure greater equality. You can look at the proposals of ATTAC or of this foundation right here. The agenda has been written, and it says stop neoliberalism. But our governments prefer to govern on behalf of the biggest players who want none of these measures. Our proposals are feasible, but not if you want to give banks and corporations everything they demand. The left knows what ought to be done, how it could be done, and can provide detailed instructions to anyone who can be persuaded to listen. It's getting them to listen that's the hardest. Talk about revolution, in quotes, as a solution has virtually disappeared, at least among the people I know on the left. I consider this progress. Everyone seems more pragmatic, more realistic, and more preoccupied by the overwhelming need to create some sort of democratic order out of the present injustice, inequality, and impending climate chaos. Most of the left seems to have recognized that revolution is not right now a very helpful concept unless it's used as a metaphor. Where could we have it? In New York? In the city of London? Some other great capitalist center? If you know the name of the Tsar, and if you have the address of the Winter Palace, I promise I'll pull on my boots and I'll come with you. But today, 100 years after quite a lot of people, a very large group of people, did exactly that, we have to recognize that capitalism somehow survived. It flourished elsewhere, it's still with us, and it's stronger than ever. Alas, democracy is also in bad shape. However, the current American revolt against Donald Trump and the Republican Congress is so far being carried out in eminently democratic ways. The movement and the clear desire for greater political engagement in the United States signals that Rosa Luxemburg was right. And when she called, and what she called the masses seemed to be on the move again. This is where I find the greatest hope. People in general, all over the world, are not just marching, not just protesting against bad politicians and worse policies, but they are quietly creating their own structures in 1,000 different ways, 1,000 different spaces. They're not actually trying to overthrow capitalism, but they're seceding from it. The numbers of startups and cooperatives, companies are growing every year, where the people work together as cooperatives, and no one exploits anyone. Cooperatives may be a 19th century idea, but they're being modernized in all sorts of ways. Food crops based on local organically grown food are spreading, and they keep prices down by having all co-op members work for a few hours a week or a month. Instead of accepting that they have to purchase individual objects they may only need once or twice a year, such as heavy equipment or tools, these can be shared. Repair shops are springing up all over the place so that we needn't buy a new object every time an old one breaks down. Cooperative transportation is another growing trend. Local currencies are thriving in many towns and regions. Cities also offer great hope and are easier to change than entire nations. The move towards remunicipalizing water and other public services, which have been privatized, is growing every year. In Spain, cities are uniting to find common ways to get rid of their debts, and they're declaring some of these debts odious. Odious debt is not a moral term, it's a technical term, which means that if the money was borrowed and accumulated by previous municipal governments and was wasted, spent fraudulently, or not used to benefit citizens, then it should not be paid. People are being encouraged to participate in city governments or even in determining their budgets, such as the participatory budget of Porto Alegre in Brazil. People are learning to create structures that are politically horizontal, rather, and these horizontal structures allow public participation at all stages, rather than vertical structures where people have to rely on their representatives and can't participate directly. They are saying loud and clear, voting is not enough. And I can't leave popular struggles against capitalism without mentioning the formidable movement against the TTIP and the CETA, particularly in Germany. You did incredible educating and mobilizing of the people. We can't win, however, without having state power on our side. And so far, the only vehicles for seizing it, at least in democracies, are elections, which are piloted by political parties. Yes, we ought to encourage and vote for parties that make good promises, but we should also be able to recall and impeach their leaders if they don't follow through and break all those promises. But the problem goes deeper than these practical solutions. We have to fight the Gramscian battle at which the neoliberals have excelled for decades. The solution against capitalism and neoliberalism will also be cultural, or it won't happen. If our German comrades could devote the same political energy to this battle as they have done to get rid of the TTIP, we could be in a much better position. The influence of officials like Schäuble or of an economic establishment which sincerely believes that the solution lies in austerity or doesn't mind harming or reducing millions of Greeks to destitution has got to be curbed, not just because it is inhumane, but because it will end up by destroying Europe. That is the Gramscian assignment I'd like to give to my comrades of the German left. Work against neoliberal dogma by explaining not just why it's wrong, but also by putting forward our values, our solutions, and packaging them in politically attractive ways. You've been remarkably patient with me, and I thank you very much. I'm very grateful to you, and I hope you have lots of questions and counter-arguments. But to conclude, I think I can't do without the help of a German, who is your poet Hölderlin. When we translate this line of his into English, it's something like, where the peril grows, there grows also what will save it. What will save us, sorry. Now, I need a German to say this in your language. So I want to thank Ingar, who will tell you what it really means in your own language. Anyway, that's the last word, and thank you ever so much for your kindness and your patience.
Thank you very much, Susan, for your talk. And now we will have a Q&A session. And please limit your questions and comments to 3 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Andreas Schlüter, sociologist. Thanks a lot, Professor Dort, for this great contribution. I would like to add something nevertheless. Well, actually, there's another terrible option coming from this concentrated neoliberal capitalist class, which culminates in the US power elite, in which the neocons are dominating, just as the arm of neoliberalism, and of course there are their desires for solving problems again more and more by military means, which opens the terrible option that capitalism just dies together with mankind. But there's also, can you hear? All right, then maybe I have to take it a bit. Okay. There is also the possibility that capitalism, declared dead since long, is actually preparing the deathbed for a vast section of mankind. And that leads me to the neocon think tanks, and especially to the neocon think tank Project for the New American Century, which issued a paper in September 2000 called, a ridiculous name anyway, Rebuilding America's Defenses. And co-founder of this Project for the New American Century, Robert Kagan, husband of Victoria Nuland, all those neocon guys, by the way, staunch supporters of Hillary Clinton. And this paper has some remarkable parts which are highly frightening, and on page 60, of this paper, Rebuilding America's Defenses, you find a paragraph ending like this. I try to commemorate it very well. If biowarfare would be developed in a way that specific genotypes could be targeted, biowarfare could develop from the realm of terror to a politically useful tool. Surely not targeting at wasp genes. And this is the continuation of the Project Coast in South Africa with the dream of the black bomb. It's the continuation of Kissinger's NSSM 200 and so forth. Yeah, this is another terrible possibility, you know, leading to the death of possibly many, many millions of people. Thank you.
There's always another horror, you know, you haven't thought of. And this is one that I had not thought of at all. And I know nothing about it, but it's a terrifying prospect. Thank you for that contribution.
Stefan Kroll, online magazine Schattenblick. You have been exploring world hunger, and we have now the merger from Bayer and Monsanto, which is quite an interesting affair, because normally the American corporations seem to be a lot bigger, and it's not going the other way around. Could you please comment a little bit out of this this new development, that there is such a lot of mergers, not only this one, but even other ones in the agro-industrial complex, and what that means for the future of the nourishment of mankind?
Corporations like that love a field where there's no competition. They talk about competition all the time, but they don't want it. And so it's very convenient to have only three companies that are making the kinds of products that Monsanto makes, which is to say GMOs, and to control that entire field. So I don't think we should be surprised. The corporations want monopoly. Competition is for all the little people. You have to compete for jobs, you have to compete for, you know, small business, but not if you're the big one.
Another question over there. Now it's on. Okay, thanks for the talk. I would be interested, you talked about the fight against neoliberalism, but don't you see there some kind of change within the Trump administration? I mean, it's not a such a typical neoliberal program he's going for. How would you describe the shift in capitalist ideology within the new US government? I mean, he's heading more towards like multi-trade agreements rather than free trade agreements. So how would you describe the
Sorry, could you stand up so I can see who's speaking? Ah, thank you. Then start again with the U.S.
Okay, how would you describe the ideological shift? I mean, the program of Donald Trump is not a typical neoliberal one. I mean, it's mixed with right-wing authoritarian parts. So how would you describe this shift within capitalist ideology? I mean, he's again against like free trade agreements and to some extent quite far from Milton Friedman or Hayek. So
something. I have to make a confession. I'm a little deaf, and when I get questions from the microphone, your English, all of you speak fantastic English. That is not the problem. The problem is my ears. So I'm going to need Ingar to help me with what the essence of the question was. And then but we'll collect that one, okay? And we'll go on to the next person.
It's in the back.
Ja, Klaus nochmal. Was ich vorhin vergessen hatte, war die Bündnispolitik. Das ist, glaube ich, unsere einzige Chance, die Frau Sachtelt ja hier, dass wir überhaupt was machen können. Aber wir müssen uns wahrscheinlich wirklich mal unsere Illusionen komplett nehmen. Wir leben in einer vollständig anderen Welt. Da hilft das auch nicht, wenn 60 oder 50 Konzerne kaputt gehen. Die spielen heute überhaupt keine Rolle mehr. Ich glaube nicht, dass es die zyklischen Krisen oder welche Art auch immer noch gibt. Das ist lange Planwirtschaft, ja. Die werden genau organisiert, wenn man guckt, in welche Zyklen Krisen gemacht werden, um dann einen Krieg vorzubereiten und den zu refinanzieren, ja, über Gebäude in den USA oder wie auch immer. Das ist alles sehr klug und hochintelligent. Ich sehe da keine Krisenanfälligkeit, sondern dieser Kapitalismus ist lange eine exakte, intelligente, superintelligente Planwirtschaft. Wir haben dir nichts entgegenzusetzen. Und wenn wir das nicht schaffen, eine Analyse zu machen, wo wir wirklich stehen, und wie die Gegenkräfte organisiert sind. Konzerne sind lächerlich, das ist Arbeiterklasse. Das ist alles, dieser Kapitalismus ist privatisiert in einer Art und Weise, wie wir uns nicht vorstellen können. Wir haben keine Vorstellung der Leute, die die Macht haben. Politiker, Konzerne lächerlich. Das ist alles Geschichte. Und wenn wir nicht auf diesen Grund dieser technologischen Entwicklung, deshalb vorhin gesprochen von Technologie, ja, von Produktivkräften, von Produktverhältnissen, und dieser Kapitalismus, der seit 100 Jahren tot ist, der hat nur noch die Chance, und jetzt verzeiht mir das Wort, ja, der Rest ist Kinderkram, uns auszurotten. Eine neue Art zu gründen, nicht den Menschen, sondern die paar Leute, die werden noch ein paar Tausend in den Urwäldern rumlaufen lassen, die absaugen, wenn sie gebraucht werden. Das war's. Die brauchen uns nicht mehr. Industrie 4.0 hat den Arbeiter und die Arbeiterklasse und die Gesellschaft erledigt. Die ist nicht mehr notwendig. Und wir müssen uns mal klar werden, in welcher Zeit wir leben. Das ist alles, es gibt keine Linke. Es gibt Leute mit linken Herzen und Leute Seele, aber Leute im Verstand, null. Nichts, nirgendwo. Alles Träumer.
Whether there is a difference between, or whether there isn't a difference between Trump with his critique of free trade, whether you know that Trump is not a disciple of Hayek and of Friedman, but whether there is an ideological shift within the capitalist class in the United States. And the second point was the person who was speaking was saying that we don't have a crisis, but we have a super planned economy by the capitalist class, and the capitalist class, because of digitalization, doesn't need workers anymore. Do you want to answer straight away?
Well, I'm afraid there isn't really a shift in the American capitalist class. I mean, if you just look at the cabinet, you see that everyone there is there either because there's a race, they're racist, or because they're something really important, billionaires in some organization. And there may be two kinds of competing factions in the new government, because half of them, I would say, of the advisors and this whole gallery of hugely disgusting people, half of them are really onto the Steve Bannon ethic of white supremacy, hatred for Muslims, let's get rid of anybody with a Latino name, etc., etc. They're really on a kind of Hitlerian program. It's different people, but they want to eliminate people, basically. But they can't, you know, I mean, they can't just mass murder, but they are going to cause a lot of deaths. And the other side is classic transnational big business. And the business about trade is maybe deceptive, but I think he's going to have to take some of that back, because the big companies do not want to change NAFTA. They have done quite well out of it. 700,000 jobs were lost in the United States economy, and millions of peasants failed in Mexico. But the US farmers are really happy about what has happened with NAFTA. So there are going to be fights within the top class in the United States, and I don't know who's going to win, but some people make the argument, well, I spent 2.5 years going around France talking about the TTIP and trying to make it known, and with a lot of other people. And, you know, you can say, well, you want the same thing as the National Front. And they've been saying that to us for years. With the 2005 Constitution, we were against it because it said exactly what the economy had to be. It said it's got to be a capitalist economy with the following aspects. And the National Front wanted for the same, but not for the same reasons. So, I mean, we won. We did get a majority. They didn't do anything about it, but we got a majority. Well, the National Front didn't want it because they didn't want Turkey to join the European Union, which was on the cards at the time. But that doesn't bother me. sometimes you can agree with the far right on some things, but not, certainly not on everything. You have to pick and choose. So I don't think there's a shift within the capitalist class that it's going to take over anytime soon. I think it's always going to be money. And the second one was capitalism needs.
Like digitalization, whether it's eliminating like the socially necessary labor, and whether that means that there is a growing army of superfluous.
Well, I think there'll be a lot of layoffs, but that argument has been put forward since the 18th century, and it's never turned out to be true, although the recovery for the people who get hit and whose jobs are lost can be very long and very painful. But the rise of new industries has always taken place. So, I mean, I'm not a prophet. I don't know the future. But I would say if this system remains in place, the same thing will happen, although the people who suffer will, and they may get a little more help than the people in England in the 18th, 19th century who were simply sent to the poorhouse. I can't answer what's going to happen in the future.
Ja, Christoph Liebe, ich muss leider auf Deutsch fragen, mein Englisch ist sehr schlecht. Ich wollte die Frage von dem Kollegen nochmal aufgreifen, weil mir deine These mit dem gramscianischen Politik, die die Linke machen muss, absolut einleuchtet und sehr sympathisch ist und auch richtig finde. Nur gerade vor dem Hintergrund doch nochmal die Frage, ob nicht der Neoliberalismus mit der Krise 2007 seine Klassenbasis, die Mittelschichten, die ja lange das getragen haben, selber vor den Kopf gestoßen hat und die Qualitätsveränderung jetzt zum Rechtspopulismus, nicht nur in den USA, auch in Europa, doch eine andere Zeitdiagnose erfordert, als einfach den Neoliberalismus, wie du das gemacht hast, bis heute fortzuschreiben. Also doch nochmal die Frage, jetzt nicht nur auf Amerika bezogen, sondern eben auch auf Europa, dass wir meines Erachtens uns neu sortieren müssen, weil wir nicht mehr den Neoliberalismus bis 2007 haben, sondern jetzt das Problem des Rechtspopulismus und einer weiteren Verselbstständigung der Demokratie und des Staates.
The question is whether, Christoph Lieber, he agrees with you that the Gramscian moment in the neoliberal counter-revolution was essential, but whether or not the crisis in 2007 marks the point where the middle class is like as a social base for neoliberalism was lost because neoliberalism worked against the interests of the middle class, and whether right-wing populism now has to be understood as like the onset of a new phase of capitalism because of being like a radicalization and eviscerating of democracy as a result.
That's a very interesting perspective. Again, I don't feel I can answer it adequately. Yes, the middle class has been hard hit. And the middle class is very much afraid of dropping down into the lower class and losing what it has gained prior to neoliberalism, and that is at the bottom of Brexit, and that I think you're right, it's at the bottom of the populist movements. The point I was trying to make is that the clash has profited the far right. It has not profited the left. Our solutions have not been accepted nearly as well by people who are maybe more or less well-educated and who, when they lose their job or they lose whatever benefit they had, it's easier always to say it's that immigrant who took my job from me rather than having a structural explanation. And that's where we are right now. And so I think the left has got to be a lot more creative in its language, in its approach, in its publications, more actual hard evidence and less theory. You see what I mean? I think we have to be, as good Gramscians as the right has been.
Do you mind standing up?
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm concerned about the national framework of the political parties, even green parties or left parties. And my question is, don't we need a more globally thinking and organizing political party, like transforming ATTAC or starting something new, which isn't kind of born out of this nationalistic thinking? What do you think about that?
Well, I wish, this is maybe a hopeless wish, but I wish politicians could leave their egos at the door, you know. I am for coalitions. We are at the point now in France, this is the country I know best, of course, I'm a French citizen, but we're going to lose again because the two candidates who, if they united, could win, probably, could be number two, because Marine Le Pen is going to be number one, but the number two could be the left, because people are fed up, and because you could have a reaction on the left of people who are fed up, just as the right has been growing stronger. But I'm afraid that's not going to happen, because the principals, who are Jean-Luc Mélenchon, who I will vote for in any case on the first round, and Benoît Hamon, who has won, and he was the farthest to the left of all the socialist candidates in the primary, and they have simply said, we're not going to get together on this. And the Greens have joined Hamon, so there you had the possibility of something which could be number two. And it isn't going to happen. I mean, we could be much more creative. And you are about to have exactly the same problem. Is Martin Schulz going to be the candidate? Well, if he keeps growing in the sondage, in the opinion polls, it looks like it. And I think a coalition is the only answer, because then at least you get your foot in the door. At least they have to listen to you some of the time. Not all the time, but some of the time. And at least you become familiar, and you are not something strange, some sort of strange new species that has somehow risen to the top. You become ordinary. Your picture's in the paper, you're on television. I mean, you see what I mean? So I think we have to be much less pure. I think purity is the purity is death to anyone who's in a minority. You have to find, I mean, look, if this is the circle of your concerns and this is the circle of mine, let's not worry about what's out here and what's out here. Let's worry about what is in the two segments of those circles. Let's develop that. Let's see what we agree on and what we can develop. This is, I mean, as I get older, I feel this is more and more the real problem, one of the real problems on the left.
In deinen Ausführungen kam nur mal marginal ein Phänomen vor, das uns hier seit 2 Jahren stark bewegt, das ist die Migration. Also dieser große Strom von Flüchtlingen, im Wesentlichen verursacht durch Kriege, Krisen, Interventionen des Nordens, der aber im Grunde ein Ausdruck von Arm und Reich in der Welt ist. Also hinter dem Ganzen steht eigentlich der arme Süden gegen den reichen Norden. Diese Bewegung wird sehr wahrscheinlich noch zunehmen und wird sie zu einer Gefahr für den gegenwärtigen Kapitalismus, oder wird sie auf andere Weise bewältigt oder geregelt werden? Wie siehst du das?
the question was how you tie together the refugee crisis, the so-called, and the migration streams from the global south, and the argument was that it's connected, obviously, to the gap between the rich and the poor, sure. between the global north and the global sure. south, and the question was whether you think that that is actually going to undermine capitalism, or whether it's going to be stabilized in one way or another, in which way that could be, if you think that's the case.
Of course, you're absolutely right that the problem is that those people who leave cannot do anything else but leave, and even those who are not subject to some horrible warfare or being bombed have a desire to leave. It's not normal to go to another country to live. I was an immigrant in France, right? I was born in the United States, and I left for France, but there were not 100,000 young women my age when I moved to France who all wanted to go to France. This is not normal. You want to stay with your family, your language, your memories, your climate, there's 100 reasons to want to stay there. So you only leave if there are reasons for it. And you should be in a minority. So of course, you are right that the only answer is to make life livable where people are. And meanwhile, if we can't understand this, then we will have to find room for more people. And I think the rest of Europe applauded when Angela Merkel was so generous, but she's maybe going to pay for that. So I don't have an answer to this, once again, what's going to happen, I don't know. But I have always been in favor of allowing people to live on their own where they are. That was the whole one of the arguments of my food books. Allow local farmers, give them either enough money, give people enough money or enough land, and they will feed themselves. They will not need us. And I still believe that if people are given a chance in life, they will take it and they will try to make good on their own. And they won't need us. They certainly won't need to come to our countries.
We have another question about this young gentleman over here.
I want to ask about this long Gramscian march. Like, there was, by the time of rising of neoliberalism, there was like, a big industry on the back of neoliberalism, yeah, who basically founded this movement, and also they had like some sort of general positive plan, what you need to do to transform economy and society, and
hang on just a moment, the right of what? They had the right to what?
Not right.
They had
but,
the right to what?
Not right. Like they have two basic things, which I think today progressive don't have. The first thing, like huge foundation sources. They was, I mean, neoliberalist movement by the time of its rising. They had like on their back, they had big industry, and second basic things that current progressive don't have. It's general positive plan. What we need to do to transform our society and economy in general. Not like some local ideas, like local project, but in general. So, yeah, my question is actually this idea of this long march, like long Gramscian march, really applicable for current progressive movement, because I don't frankly see these basic two things by current progressive.
The long march through the institutions, I'm not sure I got the whole point of what you're saying.
that the neoliberals like have two advantages over progressives, namely that on the first thing is that they have capital funding, big industry behind them, and the foundations. The second thing, what was the second thing?
A general plan, like a general vision,
not local projects, like localism, but a general vision of how to transform.
Well, I think your analysis is perfectly correct. The amount of money that was poured into this idea producing and dissemination is absolutely enormous. I wrote a book about this called Hijacking America, and I only dealt with the mechanics of it. How did they do it? And if you take a foundation like the Heritage Foundation in the United States, they brag about having at least 6 interviews every day with some national publication, and they have their own television studio on the premises. They have everything for communication. And this is the rule in the United States, and it is now going to Britain, and now they have an organization, not Heritage, but the whole movement. They have an organization which I think is called Atlas, and which does exactly the same sort of propaganda work in Eastern Europe. So it's not surprising. Of course, you have a fertile field in Eastern Europe because the politics are completely reversed from ours. Everything that's left for us is right for them, and everything that is right for is anyway. I mean, it's a complete reversal. So I think they've been immensely clever and far-seeing. It took them a little while to get started. It starts with Hayek in the 50s. With the Mont Pelerin Society, of which Margaret Thatcher was one of the early members. And it worked. I mean, they took neoliberal economists when nobody else was listening to them, and they developed a doctrine. And then there were a certain number of gurus in the United States, like Irving Kristol, people like that, who had, he called himself, I'm a left-winger who has been mugged by reality. And he moved to the far right. And he went around and talked to these people, to the funders, to the Olin Foundation, to the Bradley Foundation, to the Scaife-Mellon Foundation, et cetera, et cetera. And he said, you people have got to understand how to change this country. If you want to do X, Y, and Z, you have to do it yourselves. Business was not, I mentioned this in the talk, business was not contributing in the United States to policy making. But in 1972, a report was prepared by the US Chamber of Commerce and a man called Lewis Powell, who later became a justice on the Supreme Court because Nixon was rewarding him. And they published this report for business, which said, you are not protecting capitalism. You have to get in there and fight and protect it. And you have to develop communication skills. You have to have people who can speak for you. And if they were not accepted on college campuses, they were very worried at the time because of the Vietnam War. And they were saying, look, half of the elite universities in this country are against capitalism. You've got to change that. I mean, if you've got people at Harvard and Yale and Princeton who are saying, I don't like capitalism and I don't want anything to do with it, you have to change that if you're in business. And so they did. And then if the college said, well, we don't want to accept you on the campus, or students are against it or whatever, then they said, you are crushing free speech. You don't want to hear both sides of the question. And this to Americans, you know, you can't tell me I'm crushing free speech. I say, okay, you can come and speak on the campus. They did this little by little, but they won. This was the big development after the Vietnam War in particular.
Like, I don't see any other hands raised, so do you want
Well, I just want to thank you, remarks? Because you've really been terrific. I spoke too long, but I couldn't cut any further because the topic was so broad and so interesting that I thought, well, you know, I think the Germans are very patient people, and so maybe they'll take it, and maybe they won't protest. And you have not only you haven't protested, but you've given me a very warm welcome. So thanks ever so much, and thanks once more to Ingar, to Mario Candellas Beckstein of the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, who had the idea of inviting me. So I'm delighted to be with you. I'm staying another 2 days to be around Berlin a little more, and thanks ever so much, and have a good rest of your evening.